Education Matters is sponsored by the Clark County School District. Better together, the Clark County School District. Ellison's Professional Services. When you get your income taxes done this year, go with who you know, Ellison's Professional Services, and your local internet station, MeU Radio Athens. Check it out at MeURadioAthens.com. My name is Fredrell Green, and joining me are my co-hosts,
Joshua Daniel,
Ethan McKenzie.
Today on Education Matters, we'll be discussing Ethan's father, Cedrick McKenzie, on his military service with our guest, Cedrick McKenzie. But before we start today's show, I'm going to give us our words to grow on. Reflect upon your present blessings, of which every man has many, not on your past misfortunes, of which all men have some, from Charles Dickens. Okay, Mr. Cedrick, how you doing today?
I'm fine. Glad to be here with you young fellows. It's an honor.
All right, sir. Tell us, why did you decide to join the military? What gave you that decision?
Well, the military, it was a last option for me. School, I wasn't doing well in college. You know, I bounced around a couple of times from school to school. And so I didn't want to be a burden on my mother. Mm-hmm. And I just, military had been a good opportunity for minorities and us coming up to break through the poverty cycle. And, it turned out to be a blessing for me and my family. So,
okay. When you first got enlisted into the military, what was it like initially?
It was a culture shock. During the time I went to boot camp, I went down to Orlando, Florida. It was like co-ed. So, in the Navy, Great Lakes, you had Great Lakes, San Diego, and Orlando. And so I was fortunate enough to get Orlando. Okay. So that was quite different, going through basic training with women. But you realize how strong women really are as well, you know. So they're a co-equal branch of us. And, so that was very interesting. And so my initial reaction to it, I remember my mom told me when I went to the military, she said, if you don't like it, just go to the nearest payphone and call back. And so I went on the USS Milwaukee. It's an oiler. And I took my bags on board and walked to my bunk. And my bunk wasn't as big as this table. And I had like two or three suitcases. And I'm like, where am I supposed to live at? So it was like right here. And so I put my bags down, walked down to the end of the pier and had the payphone, waited in line. And I picked up the speaker to talk, call home. And I just heard some of my boys say, you know, give it a chance. You know, so, and I gave it a chance. And 20 years later, you know, I retired.
Did you have any fellow soldiers during your initial coming up in the military to help you get more acquainted, or anyone to help you? Like, did you get any buddies?
Oh, yeah. That's one thing about the military, especially when you're young, you first come in, and especially in the Navy. The Navy, we had the best ports and that we hit on a ship. So it was more of a college atmosphere back then. They call it old salt. You know, the Navy wasn't run like a business then. And so, it was more of a family structure that it is, I would say, at my latter stage of my career. But I have a lot of people from all over the country, all over the world, who came for similar circumstances, and we bond together to help each other out.
Okay. Did you get to go overseas see any combat?
I went overseas, but since I was on the ship, we went in combat areas. I never, we dropped off the Army. We had the earthquake in Haiti back in 94, 95, around that time. But as far as being in imminent danger for combat in the Navy, no, not dodging bullets, no, but in the area.
Okay.
Have you visited any countries while you was on sea?
Oh, many countries. Spain, Italy, France, Africa, Morocco. I love Japan, Guam, and a few others. I love Spain. That would be my number one place to live. I could live in Spain, would think nothing of it.
So why would you say Spain would be your number one place out of all those places you just named?
Well, Spain, Spain was conquered by the Africans. Mm-hmm. So it's a lot of our culture there, mm-hmm. For it being African-American. And the cost of living. Mm. It's a beautiful country, a lot of nice beaches. I like to be around water since I'm a sailor. And so I think that the number one place for me to live outside the country, that would be my number one choice. Mm.
What were some of the things you think you took? What were some of the takeaways from, going to all those countries, visiting all those places? Like, did you learn any of their languages? Did you take any souvenirs or anything like that?
The number one thing that I've learned going to those countries is that the world is smaller than we think. That's number one. Number two is, people, we're all the same. We all want, long life, health, and secure of happiness. So that's the takeaway that I had. And also that you can live in other parts of the world just as comfortably as you can here.
So when you was when you went on these places, did it change your perspective how you sought out the world to be, or how you sought the world thought it was until you went to all those places and you seen how different it was?
I guess a better way to say it was, did it change your view on the United States? Because
and just the whole world in general before you.
Yes, most definitely. I would say we kind of bittersweet, or it as a African American, seeing your country betray you in a light, that a negative light to the world, and you serving the country, that's something you have to reckon with and really look in yourself and realize that it's a bigger goal. How far us as a people have to go, because we have negative images that is portrayed from our country and the same country you help fighting for. That's something that a lot of us really had to take a step back and just realize that we're doing this for us, but it's a lot of change. We still need to make as a country.
So you would say that your military service gave you the chance to see a lot more of the flaws the United States had, instead of instilling more pride in your country.
Yeah, I would say I seen. Up front, the flaws and the positives.
Okay. What were some of the positives?
Well, the positives is that, when other people around the country, they depend on America for us to come and help them in their situations. And being a powerful country, no matter how the power was acquired, you still do a lot of good. But the politics of it, which, we have no control over, I had no control over at my level, that that's something totally, totally different. But when you can see other people smile when you come liberate a country or you come protect them, that means a lot to your soul and your spirit.
Did you, talking about saving people and doing all that, did your family ever look... How would you just describe the way your family would view you Like, would you say your son here, Ethan, views you more as a hero now because of your service? Or Ethan, how would you I guess what I'm trying to ask is, Ethan, how would you view your father after him talking about all the service he's done? Do you see him as a hero?
I mean, I've always seen him as a hero. But with this being said, I have learned a lot more about my dad in these few minutes, and more about his point of views of the world and the country in general.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Going back to your education, Mr. Cedrick, do you feel like, do you ever think about, man, I wish I would have gone back to college?
Well, not as far as education. Now this is something that I want you to hear, especially my son. Like, the military, far as I'm concerned, for me, helped me become a better student. Because when you go to take certain military classes, either you pass or get kicked out. And you have to maintain at least an 80 grade to get a passing grade for that course. And the pace of the course is a whole lot faster than in the United States school system.
You just gave me something very intriguing.
And also, while you're working, you're getting credits for college credits for going to basic training, for going to different schools. So your hours steady adding up for whatever institution you want to transfer your military credits to.
So the military, basically what you're saying is, for a lot of the people that want to go in, it's a lot harder than what you're dealing with at home in college. Like, the learning, the classes are a lot harder. You got to learn stuff a lot faster. You got to take it in a lot more. So what would you say about what would you say to someone who wanted to go into the military, who they feel like, you know, I'm sorry, we'll be right back after these messages.
Oh, that's a good question.
That's a great question.
Oh, that's a good one.
Excellent question.
That's a great question.
You are listening to Education Matters, where great questions get asked and answered.
Welcome back to Education Matters, the official voice of the youth, here with our guest, Cedrick McKenzie, talking about his military service. But before we get back into the topic, we're going to have Ethan McKenzie with our word of the week.
The word of the week is heresy. Belief or opinion contrary to orthodox religious doctrine, especially in Christians. Jeremiah was burned for heresy.
And that was our word of the week. Now, Mr. Cedrick, the question I was trying to get with you in the last segment, I was trying to ask you, what would you say to a youth who has bad grades, they can't seem to apply to any kind of college, and they see, and a lot of their friends tell them that the military is probably the best way to go. They think it's going to be an easy ride for them. What kind of thing, like what kind of, if you were like trying to get someone to apply to the military, what were some of the things you tell them that you feel like any other person wouldn't? Like what should they expect?
Well, the first thing, a misconception of a lot of young people about the military is they think that boot camp is like every day of their career. Mm-hmm. You know, and it's not like that. You're going to go through boot camp. The purpose of that is to tear you down, to build you back up. And so, you know, I would let them know that nothing worth having is going to be easy. And for me, you know, I like to get to know people because everybody's not meant for the military. We have, you know, trades. You might want to do a trade. You might want to go get you a job before you go in the military, or you might want to go to college. So it's very important you get to know the person before you give out, you know, suggestions. But for me, I give the positive and the negatives.
You mentioned that the military can help you with going into college, correct?
Yes.
So why didn't you choose to go back in after it had taught you all that stuff and gave you the opportunity to do that? Why'd you choose to stay the course and do as many years as you did?
Because I didn't want to go back to where I was from. That's a lot of motivation, you know. And my mother was, she raised me and my sisters, and she got remarried when I was like 15 years old. So I just didn't want to be a burden on her. And I wanted to finish what I started. So that was my main purpose of continuing on.
How did your family take you to joining the military?
How they talk me to going to the military?
No. How they respond?
Well, they responded, everything I did, I wanted to do, I was supported. You know, people, your family nurture you and they proud of you. If as long as it's something positive, then they was happy for me. So, I never had no negative issues come push back from family like that. Only thing for me is that seeing my father coming out the fields in the Army with gout, you know, I say I don't want to be that age coming out the fields like that. So that's why I chose the Navy.
So you mentioned your father also served as well.
Yes.
How would you... Did that have anything to do with you going in the military? Was it the fact that, well, if he could do it, that you could, or was it just something of your own volition?
Oh yeah, most definitely. Most definitely. You know, my father retired as well. You know, I had cousins that was, you know, in Army and Navy. And as far as seeing a lot of my relatives and a lot of people in the community coming back from the Army, and they couldn't find jobs because you can do a whole 20 year by faking out lines and stuff like that, but it doesn't translate. So I was looking for jobs that translated for once I got out.
Okay.
And so that's why I did human resources in the Navy and I'm doing human resources now.
Can you describe exactly what it is? Human resources, like you said, that you do in the military. Can you tell me what exactly that is?
Well, human resources, every major corporation, they have a personnel admin department to process your benefits, your pay, awards, et cetera. You know, when I first came in, I went in undesignated. Undesignated in the Navy means that you're scored and dictate for you to get a high level job. And you said you was going to come in as a fireman, airman, or seaman and work until you decide what you want to do. And thus, that's why I got on one of the hardest working ships in the Navy and all of them. And so, thank God that ship decommissioned after about 6 months. They sent me to the USS Dwight D. Eisenhower aircraft carrier. And they put me in supply, and a guy got tired of me humping boxes, and he was in personnel. So he's like, "Hey, bro, I'm tired of you seeing you humping boxes every day. I'll just put your qualifications in your record. Just take the personnelman test." And that's what I did.
What did you do once you aborted the aircraft carrier?
What did I do? They stuck me in supply. And I was humping supplies from Maine to Maine, like from the galley, which is the cafeteria to non-Navy folks. And, you know, Maine, the Maine's where we store the materials at, and driving forklifts, moving pallets, and the staging equipment from one Maine to the other every day.
What were some barriers you went through as a serviceman in the military, as an African American?
In the military? Well, when I was in boot camp, I had discrimination in boot camp with the TV. You know, it was a couple of African Americans in the lounge, and white sailors, you know, he just came, turned the channel and said, you know, he turned it from the N-word and you know, while he was thinking we was in prison or something. So, and that escalated. And so that was toward the end of my boot camp. And so they kept him, they was gonna process him out. And we've been taught that all while I was in boot camp, no discrimination. However, when I was about to board, catch the flight out from boot camp, they called me in and said, the guy said I said something to him, and which was a lie. So we were both in a waiting room, and I went to him and I said, hey, bro, just tell the truth. And so I guess he had a change of heart. He went and told him the truth, and they let me come home. And so when I got to Norfolk, Virginia, one of the first person I seen at the lounge and pool tables was him. So that knocked all that talk about, zero tolerance. But that's something that you're going to have throughout your career. The thing about it is you have to learn to overcome that. That's just a part of what we have to go through, you know. So don't spend your life thinking about it. You know, when you did, just deal with it, overcome it, and keep moving.
I've heard you bring up boot camp a lot. What do you do in boot camp, and how long is it for?
Boot camp is usually 8 weeks, unless you fail a test or something, they move you back. But boot camp is where they tear you down and build you up mentally. You know, you might do, they tell you to do 1,000 push-ups. They know you're not going to do 1,000 push-ups. They just want to see you try. Okay. So that's what it's all about, never give up. And, you know, I tell people the Navy, they don't teach you how to swim in the Navy. They teach you how to float.
Oh.
Yeah, they teach you how to float. So in float in the Atlantic Ocean, Pacific Ocean, that's the number one tactic, and especially with our dungarees, how you tie the dungarees up at the end and hold it up and get half oxygen and half water, and that'll keep you afloat. But the salt water holds you up. You try to swim in it, you're gonna die quick.
Who was your boot camp instructor like? And can you tell me, like, was he like any stereotypical boot camp instructor? Like, he would get in your face, cuss you out. Like, how did he treat you?
Oh man, like, I can't remember the guy's name, but he was from the Caribbean, and he was the stereotypical boot camp. Yes, he was, they all let him more.
So that's all real.
That's all real doing boot camp. Yes.
Thank you. We'll get back into the next segment, and we'll be right back after these messages.
Oh, that's a good question.
That's a great question.
Oh, that's a good one.
Excellent question.
That's a great question.
You are listening to Education Matters, where great questions get asked and answered.
Before we continue on, we have Fajora Green giving us our scholarships.
The scholarship of the week is the Hope Scholarship. The Hope Scholarship is a merit-based award available to Georgia residents who have demonstrated academic achievement. A Hope Scholarship recipient must graduate from high school with a minimum 3.0 grade point average, as calculated by GSFC, and maintain a minimum 3.0 cumulative post-secondary grade point average to remain eligible. The scholarship provides tuition assistance to students pursuing an undergraduate degree at a Hope Scholarship eligible college or university in Georgia. This was your Scholarship of the Week, sponsored by Athens Tech.
All right, so Mr. McKenzie, so in the last week you was talking about how your father went into the military and now you went into there. And so my question to you is, do you want your son to live on that tradition that you and your father had going on?
No, I don't want him to live on that tradition. I try to support him in everything he do, what I do. Mm-hmm. But, you know, as long as it's something positive, and he got a good understanding of, where he wants to go with it, you know, I support him. Mm-hmm. So, no, as far as, you know, I'm not too big into traditions and giving him my whole name and things of that nature. We are individuals, you know, regardless, he's our own individual.
Mm-hmm. Well, now that you're a vet, can you tell me what was the greatest achievement you had as a serviceman in the Navy?
The greatest achievement I had was, you know, I had a few. Going to Haiti and after the hurricane and providing goods to them. When I went to CB's over in Guam and we had a detachment in Philippines, we was fighting. Nobody knew it. But we helped a lot of people in the Philippines. And, you know, just being a positive influence on and helping people in other countries who were getting over war or famine. And we just responded with humanitarian needs. So
what were, did you get any awards or any medals or anything from your service?
Yes, I got a lot of, a couple Navy and Marine Corps Achievement Medals for outstanding service, Joint Service Medals for, you know, working with the, like, Army, you know, for liberating Haiti. And, you know, we get individual personal medals, but you get that when time. So, but medals, I would say helping other people like those medals, you know, I cherish the most.
Going back to the last question for Joe, I asked you, what are CBs that you said?
CBs is construction battalions. Mm. It was organized during World War One. You know, they build bridges in an instant, you know, for Army, Navy, Air Force, Marines. I was Navy Mobile Construction Battalion 1, who was located in Gulfport, Mississippi. They engineers, the best engineers in the world. And they model, we build, we fight. Can do. So, and that's, and that, you know, that's the truth. We build, we fight.
Okay. How would you describe the financial benefits from joining the military? Like, what was the pay like?
Well, the pay, I'll tell you, when you first get in there, the pay, you go wish you would have probably stayed in school. Stayed in school, but over time, you know, you get paid. You can pay good. You get housing allowances. And the biggest motivation for me is being able to retire in 20 years and getting a paycheck for the rest of your life. And also, you know, and I was so naive to it. You know, we veterans, and it wasn't until I got it 10 years in, I realized I'm going to get another check, too, with the VA. Mm. So you get your retirement check, and when you're done, they go through your medical history, medical records, whatever ailments you have, they pay you for that as well. Mm. So you get two checks. So, but that was, you know, that was good motivation. And also, Barack Obama came out with the post 9/11 GI Bill.
Can you explain to me what that is?
Yes, the post 9/11 GI Bill, it is extended after 9/11. It enhanced the benefits of the Montgomery GI Bill. So not only we got housing allowances for going to school, depending on what's your locality where you live at, like you was active duty, and also, you know, you get a check every month from going to school. So I had like a year left to finish my bachelor's degree, and you know, and once I got that check, I feel like that first month, I feel like I can go get my doctorate. So that's good motivation. And also, you can pass it down to your kids. And so I still have 3 years left, you know, for the housing allowance I could pass on to my son. But since I'm 100% disabled vet, he go to college for free if he choose to.
What would, with all the benefits you mentioned, what do you think about the soldiers that that come back from their service? I don't know if I'm right about this, but you hear on the news a lot about the veterans who come back. They don't get that kind of treatment. A lot of them come in, they don't get as much pay, or they come back with mental illnesses from like their service in the war or anything like that. What do you think of that, the treatment of most veterans? Like, do you know any buddies that you know that?
Yeah.
That get treated poorly after their service.
Well, that's and that's real. A lot of people, as far as PTSD, other mental health issues, they get caught up in the system. You know, us veterans, you know, we say the VA motto is hurry up and wait. So a lot of people can't wait. And so you don't want to get caught up in the system like that, but the process is not as good what it should be to get these veterans help, but it's not as bad as it was 5-10 years ago. But the system needs to be overhauled to make it easier for people to get the access what they need. And so that's still a big problem in this country. And so I, you know, hopefully they can make it, you know, make it a whole lot better here shortly. And while that's happening, we're still losing a lot of veterans. So, you know, we still got a lot of work to do.
You told us that the branch you serve in is the U.S. Navy. How exactly did you land in that specific branch? Do you not get the choice of going into the, like, whatever branch you want? Do they just put you in what they deem you necessary to serve in? Like, how does that work?
No, you choose the branch you want to go to. That's a part of the homework you have to do. When you're looking, you know, like for me, I told you earlier, I used to see my father come home out the field with gout and got the field smell on him. And so I was like, I don't want to be 40 some years old coming out the field. And I knew my cousin was in the Navy, and they said a quality of life. So as a younger man, you know, you do the physical fitness and all that stuff with, you know, Army and Marines, but you got to think long term. And so I had some relatives who made me see that. You know, you're not the same person you are at 45 that you was when you were 25. Mm-hmm. So that was part of my decision.
Talking about a situation that came up earlier last year with Joe Biden, the president of the United States' decision to call back soldiers out of Afghanistan after years and years of service there. What is your opinion on that decision by the president as a veteran?
Well, it was a political decision. And a lot of times, political decisions is not good decision when you're talking about military personnel. Military personnel, the general should have made that call. And I feel as though the politicians should have listened. And you put a lot of people was in danger. Same thing happened years ago with Afghanistan and United States. They used to be our friends when the Afghans were fighting the Russians. But we did the same thing to them, which they turned on us. And who can blame them?
So you're opinion on that decision is that it should have been up to the military. But do you think that they should have left in general or stayed?
They should have stayed until it was safe. Let me take that back. We should still have some type of presence there.
Thank you for that response, and we'll be right back after these messages.
Oh, that's a good question.
That's a great question.
Oh, that's a good one.
Excellent question.
That's a great question.
You are listening to Education Matters, where great questions get asked and answered.
Welcome back to Education Matters. We're here with our guest, Cedrick McKenzie. But before we get back into the next segment, we got Fredrell with To Your Health and the History Facts.
The To Your Health today is on your fat. Did you know that most of the fat you lose exits your body via your lungs? While deep breaths don't burn too many calories, this is how most burned off fat exits your body. You may have thought it was mostly through sweat, urine, or some other excretion, but the truth is that you exercise or go about your day, the majority of the fat you lose, 84%, according to 2014 research published in the British Medical Journal, is converted into carbon dioxide and leaves your body through your lungs. The remaining 16% is converted to water, which exits your body through urine, feces, sweat, tears, or other bodily fluids. And this was your To Your Health, sponsored by Drug Free Athens. And now on to the history fact. The history fact for today is, on January 24th, the U.S. Department of Homeland Security came into being as Tom Ridge was sworn in as the agency's first secretary. This was your history fact, sponsored by nobody.
So, Mr. McKenzie, I wanted to ask, how is, since you're retiring now as a veteran, how has your personal life been for you?
Well, the transition, it's been smooth. It take like at least about 2 years to get readjusted back into mainstream society from the military. Mm. And so, after I adjusted, that was fine. I said I wanted to coach and get a federal job. Mm. And so once I retired from the Navy, I got a job coaching basketball at Windsor High School in Virginia. And I got a federal job with Norfolk Operations Center in the shipyard in Portsmouth, Virginia. Mm. So my transition, it was smooth, mm. So...
When did you retire from the mm-hmm. Navy?
Mm-hmm. I retired from the Navy 2013, mm-hmm. February 28th.
Oh, so your anniversary's coming up then?
Yeah, my anniversary's coming up. Those years go by fast. Mm. But I enjoy being out the Navy more than I do being in. So it's been a blessing.
Mm. You mentioned that you coached after the military, and you also got a federal job. How was that? What was the coaching like for you?
Coaching was, I love coaching. I was an athlete. I played basketball, and I just wanted to give back to youth. And in Windsor High School in Virginia, it was a nice school, and they were struggling, and just the camaraderie and to build a better basketball program and learn the community there, and it was really a blessing to me. I got more out of it than they probably did.
That federal job you were talking about, you got me curious with that because you never really mentioned. What exactly was it that you did with that federal job?
It was human resources. I'm an HR specialist recruiter. Mm-hmm. And that's why I say when you go in, if you want to go into military, make sure you can get a job that translates outside when you get out the military. Mm-hmm. Because in the past, a lot of veterans, they didn't pick a job that translated outside to the outside workforce. Mm-hmm. And so that's one thing I learned about, my relatives from the past, my uncles, cousins, or whatever. And so it was a smooth transition for me because my experience as a personnel specialist in the military, it was the same as for a human resource specialist in the civilian world, in the civilian sector. And so since I'm a veteran and I have veteran preference, you get that when you're in the military, or if you got ailments or illness from the VA, you know, you get preference for that as well. So I had a lot of eligibilities to apply to a federal job. And that's been great.
Do you miss the military at all?
I miss my first 4 years of the military because it was innocent years, and my first time being away from home that long, and the friendships that I made with the lifelong friendships, especially during that first 4 years, I never forget it.
Since you talked about the military and everything, what would you give if a person was going to the military? What advice would you give them going into it, or how would you tell them to prepare for all the things you got with boot camp, or just anything they wanted to specialize in from the Navy or workforce?
The advice I would give them is first, know what you want to get out of it. Now pick a branch of service that best suits you. Make sure that you, you and your recruiter have a good relationship and you get the job that you want, and have an open mind when you go, because some people don't, and they keep the same attitude. But like I said, the point of it is a boot camp is it's only 8 weeks, and it's to tear you down and bring you up. And boot camp, once you leave boot camp, it's like a regular job, as far as, you know, until, you know, unless you in a combat unit or something like that. So a lot of people think, you know, boot camp is every day in the military. No, I couldn't have made it if it was like that.
I don't think anybody could.
No. So that's the advice I would give them.
So you could say boot camp mentally prepared you for just life, you could say.
Well, I wouldn't say it prepared me for life. It prepared me for the stresses of the military. Your life experiences, no matter where you're in, and you know, it's gonna prepare you to move on forward. You know, that's what we learn from, regardless, military or not.
If you are recruiting, and there were two options. You would have someone who is less likely to go to college, doesn't have that many good grades, between someone else who is a lot more likely to go to college, has really good grades. Which one of those two would you pick to go to recruit into the military, and why?
Well, I would have to talk to that individual more in depth, but if you have a person that's struggling with his grades, is not fit for college, or he already made that decision, I would tell him, you know, if he wants to try the military, I would tell him to try the military, and move forward, because obviously, you know, one option is off the table. You know, and so that's the thing. You know, I made the military my last option. You know, and I think that these days, you know, I would advise, especially young black brothers and minorities, to make their last option. We came a long way from 10, 20 years ago when it used to be our first option. So because it's a lot of other things you can do out there, and to keep the family structure intact, because a lot of stress on the military families is very hard.
What were your options before the military?
My options were school and get a job or the military. And so The jobs in Mississippi where I come from, it was, you know, the chicken plant. And then school, you know, I wasn't doing good at school and schools because at the time as a young male, you have, you know, for me, you don't want to go back and be a burden on your family, your mother. Mm-hmm. And time goes by fast. And I just believe for young males in general, from 18 to 25, if you're not doing nothing by that time, then you're going to be lost. So the military was my last option. I took it, and it paid off.
Should the military always be an option for anyone, whether they're doing poorly in school or doing real good? Like if, for instance, I don't mean to brag, but I seem to be doing pretty well in school. I have a 3.0 plus college. A lot of schools, I wouldn't say they're interested, but I'm most likely to go into college without any issues. Should I still consider the military to be an option? Like,
no.
Why not?
Because you got multiple options. There's a lot more things to do now than it was when I went in. That's why I made it my last option. You know, you have to have a foundation to springboard off of. You know, and that was my last option, so I made it my my springboard. Even when I retired, it was just a stepping stone to me. You know, so, you know, whatever, it's your comfort level, whatever your realm you in, and you got a safe comfort zone and stable there, you know, don't get content with it. Be looking and working hard to springboard off that foundation and move forward. Now, you know, the military, I would say at this time right now, it don't have to be an option anymore for especially black and brown folks in the United States.
Would you consider yourself the with the position that you were at when you first got into the military, you had really no other option but that? Would you consider yourself a role model for doing that? Or like, should anyone want to follow in your footsteps?
Well, I would say be your own person. I try to be, you consider me a role model, so be it. I think I always try to be a good influence on anybody that I meet or mentor, especially my son or like the kids I coach in basketball. And so and that's a question. I don't think I'm a role model per se, but I just feel like if you see some positive, I try to give out positive vibes, then that's fine.
How would you say your military experience translated into fatherhood? Mm.
Well, my military experience into fatherhood, I don't think my military, well, as far as the time apart with my son and I think it made me want to. That's why I came down to Georgia, to get close to my son. That was the influence, you know, being away for periods of time. That was influence to cherish every moment, because when I was at the CBs, you know, I used to see 4 or 5 year old kids. We come back, deploy every 7 months, and the whole family out there, and the kids didn't even know their mother or father.
My last question for you, Mr. Cedrick, why does education matter?
Education matters because the information is power. The more you know, the more you can pass on. And I just tell your kid, read a book, because everything they don't want you to know is in books.
Thank you, Mr. Cedrick. And thank you for listening to Education Matters, the official voice of youth. Education Matters is sponsored by the Clark County School District, Ellison's Professional Services, and MeURadioAthens.com. If you missed any portion of this program or would like to hear it again, it can be heard Monday at 5:30 or Thursday at 10 a.m. on MeURadioAthens.com or on demand from our YouTube channel, Education Matters Network. Education Matters is a production of the High School Completion Initiative. Goodbye.
Oh, that's a good question.
That's a great question.
Oh, that's a good one.
Excellent question.
That's a great question.
You are listening to Education Matters, where great questions get asked and answered.